Hey gamers, welcome to my game room. AJ from Rolling with the Roc here. It's Tuesday, ROCtober 6th, and Roc Reviews, welcome to. Designed by Benoit Turpin and published by Blue Cocker and Deepwater Games. Before we get into Welcome To, just want to give you a reminder that it is the month of ROCtober, and all month long I am releasing new content every Monday through Saturday here on this YouTube channel, as well as Sunday nights I am streaming over on my Twitch channel. You can see links for that in the description and on the channel page. I am also doing Board Game Trick or Treat at the end of the month, and all you have to do to enter that is to be a subscriber to this YouTube channel and leave a comment on any video marked ROCtober that earns you one entry per video. So you can earn as many entries as I do videos during the month of ROCtober. I will be doing a giveaway at the very end of ROCtober on Halloween Day, more than likely. I think that's my plan. And if you would like to contribute to Board Game Trick or Treat in any way, please send me an email at rollingwithroc@gmail.com. Also, if you're watching this, please go ahead and share it with your friends. Every share, like, comment, subscribe, that helps this channel so much. You know, still very, very small in the grand scheme of things, and I'm just looking to get some growth and hopefully go for even bigger and better things in year two of Rolling with Roc. So thank you very much. So on to Welcome To. Welcome To is a flipping right game, which is very similar to a rolling right game, but there is no dice. It is all card driven, where you will be flipping cards out, taking the actions available, and then filling out a player sheet. Each player will have one of these sheets, and you will all be using the same pool of cards to take your actions, trying to compete for city plans. It happens over the course, each game has a different amount of rounds based off of how the players play and what city plans, so it can be a short game or a long game depending on the players and the city plans. But it's roughly about 25 to 30 minutes in length and can play as many players as you have a player sheet for. So the box says 1 to 100 because they provide you with 100 player sheets at the beginning. For all that said, I'm going to go ahead and bring you down to the table. I'm going to show you how to set up a game of Welcome To, show you how to play, and then we'll come back for my final thoughts and my Roc rating. So here we are with a game of Welcome To set up on the table. I'll go through and let you know everything that you have to do. The first thing you do is you will give each player their own player sheet from the stack here. I have mine laminated player sheet, so that's what I will be using. You can give players the little player guide that helps explain all of the actions and the distribution of the numbers, as well as the game end conditions. You will deal one project card of each of the three. So there's a bunch of stacks of N1s, N2s, and N3s. So you give one from each of those. And those are the project cards for the game. And then you will distribute the cards in three equal piles. I am using some card holders that I have, but you can just set them on the table as well. I just wanted them to be contrasting from the mat below. So what we will do is each player is trying to get these completed on their boards. And what these are groups of houses. So you can put, you're going to write housing numbers on your player sheet across on the three streets. Let's go ahead and flip the cards for the first round, and I'll show you what we can do. So this is what we have to work with in round one. And we have a number 4 with a biz action, a number 8 with a fence action, and a number 8 with a park action. And you can write those numbers anywhere on your sheet, but your numbers have to go from left to right on your player sheet. Now, I have this looking at me, so in this case, you know, from left to right. But, so I could put a 4 or an 8 on my sheet. Those are the only two numbers that I can use for this. When I use a biz action, I can put a second number on any of my existing houses. It doesn't have to be on that 4. So if I wrote a 4 on my player sheet right here, let's just say I put it there, I could put a 4 biz there or here on the left or the right of it, not both, just on one or the other. But I could also do it if I had a bunch of numbers already and I had, you know, and I wrote the 4 down and let's say I had a 12 over here, I could put a 12 biz and you just mark that by putting a B over there. Now what the biz does is it does extend, so it helps you fill in housing on your streets, but you have to fill in a bubble under the biz action at the bottom of the sheet in the scoring area. And that's going to make you lose points the more bizzes that you do during the game. The fence action, so if I write an 8, I can put a fence, which there's dotted lines between each plot of land. I can draw a line through it, and that allows me to build a fence. Fences are what allow you to complete these specific city plans, because these want to have a number of houses between two fences. You're already automatically having fences on either end of your street. So if you wanted to complete a 4 house estate, if you had 1, 2, 3, 4, and you put a fence right there, that would be a 4 house estate. If you had a second one, 9, 10, 13, because you don't have to have them in exact numerical order, they just have to be going from ascending order, lowest to highest, and then you had another fence right there, you could claim city project number 1 by drawing a line above that and a line above that one, and you've cashed in those two city projects for two estates for city project number 1, which would earn you 6 points. So I'll go ahead and show you what I'm talking about here. If I had a 1, 2, 3, 4 and a fence right here, there's always a fence right there, that could count as one of the 4 house estates right here. The other one, 8, 9, 10, 13, with fences on either side counts there. So I draw a line above that one and write 6 points in my N1 spot if I'm the first one to complete that. If somebody else was to complete that city project before me, we flip it over after somebody completes it. Instead of getting the 6 points, I would only get 3 points. If I was to get an 8 park and put that on my sheet, I fill in the leftmost bubble above the street for the park action. So I'll go ahead and show you right here is the parks above each street. There is a different number of bubbles. When you put a park down on that street, you must use the park action on that street. You can't put the bubble on the second street when you write the number on the first street. So I wrote the 8 on the first street, I filled in the bubble, and you get increasing points for each street as you fill in those bubbles. There are a couple other actions you can do. Good, we got the estate, we got the pool, and I did not plan that, but that was perfect. No, I'm missing one. I'm missing the temp agency. I'll go over that in a minute. But so we got the estate. When you get an estate, if I put in a 1 for an estate, what you do is you come down to the bottom of your sheet here in this area, and it has lines for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are how much each of your estates are going to be worth for that size of an estate. So right now I've got 2 estates of 4. So based off of this setup, I'm looking to get estates, 2 estates of 4, a 3, a 6, a 1, 2, and 6. So 2 sixes and 2 fours. So anytime I get the estate action, I might put those into the 6s and 4s, as those would be the ones I'd be most likely making on my player sheet. As you do that, you increase the point values of those sizes of estates if you complete them with a fence on both sides. The pulls, so I would like fill in bubbles for the estates, kind of like that, and those would help with scoring. The pulls, this 2 pull here, if I was to use that on the turn, I could put a 2 pull right there. And what you do is you put in your number as well as circle one of the pulls above that number. So you can't, if you take the to pull action and you put it on a space where there's no pull, you just don't take the action. But if you have it where you're putting it above a pull, you can circle the pull. If you put a number where there's not a pull, or like right here where I did this when I didn't have a pull action, you would just cross that pull off and you do not get that pull. But when you do fill in a pull, you're going to fill in the left and topmost bubble. And as you get more pulls, they equal more points, all the way up to 36 if you get all of the pulls. The last action we can do, let me see if I can find it here, is the temp agency. There we go. So in the temp agency, this is an 11 at the moment, but the temp agencies allow you to increase or decrease that number by 1 or 2. So that number could be anywhere from a 9 to a 13. And let's say I wanted to put it on this side of my biz, I could increase that by 2, make it a 13. Now, no matter if you can actually make that a 0 as well. And what that means is that if you wanted to take that 11, you could still technically take the temp agency action, which allows you to fill in the bubble for the temp agency right here. And the players who have the most bubbles in their temp agency will get points at the end of the game. You're going to get 7 points if you have the most, 4 if you have the second most, and 1 if you have the third most, and players share ties. So you could have a couple people tied at first, a couple people tied at second, a couple people tied at third. And so all of that combined is what will lead to scoring at the end. You know, just filling in numbers here, you got 4, let's say we got 6 on that park, and we got 2 on that park, and we completed that city plan and that city plan, but not first. We got a couple of these, and so we finished second. We got a couple of pulls, and so we got 21. We did good on our states, whatever. Used a couple of business, so we're going to get minus 6. When we took a building refusal permit, and what that means is if you get a building refusal permit is when you cannot put a number. If a number comes up, let's say I've already done all the high numbers here, and everything goes up to, the cards are numbers 1 through 15, but there's only 3 copies of the 1, 2, 4, and 15 in the deck. So let's say I've done all my high numbers, and then I only get like 13, 14s, and 15s. I can't manipulate the numbers in any way. I can't place that. I have to put in a building refusal permit. And the first time you do that, you don't lose any points. The second time you do that, you're going to lose 3 points at the end of the game. And the third time you do that, you're going to lose 5 points at the end of the game, and it triggers endgame. That is one of the 3 endgame conditions. The 3 endgame conditions are: one player completes all 3 city projects. It doesn't have to be the first player to do so. They just have to have completed all 3. A player has all 3 building refusal permits, and therefore they can't do anything else. They've ended the game. Or a player has filled in a number on every single one of their housing plots. Any of those conditions ends the game for all players. And the other thing that you can do in the advanced variant is a roundabout. And the way a roundabout works is you put a fence on either side of a house and then draw a circle inside of it, looking like this. Now, what that does is that you could have, that basically makes it 2 separate streets. So you could have a 12 on the left side of that roundabout and then start back over at 1 on the right side. Now, when you do that, it does cost you some points. You can do that twice in the game. When the first time you do it, it costs you 3 points. The second time you do it, it costs you a total of 8 points, so another 5. But that can be beneficial when you are playing this game. I've used a roundabout to my advantage, especially when you're trying to get some fences. I've actually used that to my advantage to get fences and fill in spots on the board depending on certain city plans. So while you are sacrificing some points, it may be good in the greater long run. The same with the bizzes. The bizzes do increasingly get more harmful as you take more of them. But if you take 2 to 3, it's usually the sweet spot. You take a couple of points loss, but they can really help you with getting the city projects faster, which keeps other people from getting points, for getting more of your estates, which will compound into more points. There's a lot of different things that you can do with those. And that is all the different actions that you can do in Welcome 2. So I showed you all the actions that you can do in Welcome 2. What I'm going to do now is just do a very quick playthrough, or at least the beginning of a playthrough. I'll see how long that goes. But we're just going to go ahead and flip cards. I'm going to take an action. I'm not really going to think too hard on it, but you can kind of get the idea of what's going to happen here. So right off the bat, we want 2 fours, a 3, a 6, a 1, 2, and a 6. So when I get estates, I'm going to go for 4s and 6s. I am going to want fences, and pools and parks are always good. So let's see if we can use this. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that 10 pool. I'm going to pop it right here. Make sure I'm in the screen. I'm going to pop it right there. And I fill in a pool bubble. And then we're going to go again. We got a 13. Sorry about that. That was a big truck that just went by. I'm not sure if that went through on the camera there or not. But that's kind of made me jump. We got a 13 park, a 6 biz, and a 5 estate. 10, 11, 12. I think I can take that 13 park and pop it right there. And go ahead and go again. And we got a 5 temp, a 9 estate, and a 5 fence. I think we'll do the 9 estate. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Oh, I can't do 6s on that. I should have probably done those another spot down. That's fine. Yeah, we'll do the 9 estate for now. And fill in one of the 4s. Then we got a 3 estate, a 9 estate, and the 13. These are all flipped. I'm going to flip that all the way around like that for now. 13 park, another 13 park. 9 and a 3. 8, 7, 6, 5. Let's go ahead and take the 3 estate. We'll put it right there and do another 4. And so you can kind of get the idea of what I'm doing here. Okay, wow, that's kind of unfortunate. We got 2 15 fences. I'll go ahead and put the 15 fence here. Not really what I was looking for. But I'm going to go ahead and put the fence right between this 9 and the 10. Because if I put 2 houses here, then I have one of my 4s. So I do like that. And an 11 fence, a 4 fence, and a 6. These cards are just all shuffled wrong. A 6 park. I am going to use that 11 fence. So I have a set of 4. I'm also going to want a set of 6. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm going to put a line right here. Because down here is a 12 houses in a row. That makes 2 perfect sets of 6. So that's a really good use of that. We've got a 5 estate, a 7 temp agency, and a 10 park. The 10 park, the 5, or the 7. None of those are really anything I really want. 8, 9, 7. I think I'll come down here. 14, 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So I can put the 10 at like here. 11, 12, 13, 14. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. Yeah, 10. We'll put the 10 park right here. And keep going like that. We got the 9 fence. We got the 8 biz and the 14. Okay, I like the 4. Ow. I'm going to take the 14 and sacrifice the pole. It does give me a temp agency. Will help me on scoring for that. We got the 9 pole, a 6 fence, and a 7. So the 9 pull is good. I can put the 9 pull right here and get a pull. Just like that. We got a 1 fence, a 6 temp agency, and a 7 pull. Is a 7 pull helpful? Not particularly. But what I can do is I can put the 7 pull here. And then if I want to, I can use bizzes to fill in those gaps if I need to. We have a 7 park, an 11 fence, and an 11 fence. That's unfortunate in some ways. So let's go ahead and put the 11 fence right there. And I do need another set of four. So 1, 2, 3, 4. I will put another fence right here. We've got a 1 estate, a 8 fence, and an 11 fence again. Wow, those 11 fences are just all over the place. I will use a... I'll use a 1. I don't want to sacrifice too many 1s. I know I've used them quite a bit so far. So, did that. We go ahead and flip these cards over again. We've got a 12 fence, a 2 pull. I like the 2 pull. And a 6 estate. I'm going to go ahead and take the 2 pull, put it here, and fill in another pull. So I've already got 13 points for my pulls, which is really good. A 10 pull, 10 estate, and 12 fence. Well, the 10 estate isn't... I could use the 10 pull up on the top row, even though I've been mostly focusing on my second and the third streets here. I could put the pull on the top. And I think that is what I'm going to do just to... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, I'm going to put it up top and get another pull. Because pulls can get a lot of points. And I'm doing pretty decent on my fencing. I don't need too much more. 13. I like that 13 park. So I'm going to take the 13 park, put it here, get more points for my park on my bottom street. And now as I'm doing all this... other players could be completing some of these city projects. I haven't completed one yet, but other players could. And when they do, just, I never flipped that card over. When they do, let's say somebody else already completed this 4x4. So they would have earned 6 points. When I complete it now, I can only earn 3. So we can have a 4 pull, a 3 park, or a 9 estate. I think I'm gonna take that 4 pull, put it on the top right there, and get even more points for my pull. Now we got a 13 pull, another 10 pull, and an 8 estate. I am going to take the 13 pull. Now my pulls are worth 26 points. So I'm getting a ton of points for my pulls. So we got 12 biz, which might not be a bad time to use that. 9 fence and 9 estate. I'm going to use the 12 biz. I'm going to put the 12 right here to complete my that set of 4. And then what I'm going to do is, because now I have a 7 here and a 9 here, I know I need to use a biz. So I'm going to go ahead and put a 9 biz right there. Now, that means I cannot put a fence between that 9 biz and that 9. That is one thing here, but I'm not going to do that anyway because I want that to be a plot of 4. So because I took a biz, I have to put a bubble in here, and now I'm losing 1 point from bizes. We got a 3 estate, a 9 biz, and a 12 temp agency. So... using the 12 and temp agency wouldn't be bad because I still need to, if I wanted to, I can put a 14 and a 15 up there so I can make that a 14. The other biz is not needed at the moment. And the three estate could go here. But I think I'm going to use the 12 as a 14 and get another temp agency for points for that. We got a 5 biz, a 15 park, which is good, and a 2 biz. So I'm going to take that 15 park and put it up here. Now, this is what I was talking about earlier. I might have just backed myself into a corner because I can no longer build anything 10 or higher, which could be bad, but that's okay. You know, we'll see how that goes. We've got a 7 park, a 14 estate, and a 7 park. So I can't do much with that. I can put the 7 park. I got a 4, 10, so 5, 6, 7. Go ahead and put the 7 right here and fill in that park. We'll keep going. 5 temp, 11 park, and 8 park. I'm going to go ahead and take the 5 temp and make it a 3 and put that right there and get another temp agency. It puts me up to 3 temps, which is pretty good so far. We got a 6 estate, an 8 park, and a 7 fence. I do want to see how many more fences I need. So I have my 2 6s. I have 2 4s ready. I have a 3 ready. I just need a 1 and a 2. So that's not bad. So I can just do... I can do a fence right... if I put a 7 down, which I'd have to do on this row, I could put a fence down right here and then only need to split 1 more fence and I would have all the fencing I need. So I think that's what I'm going to do. I think I'm going to take the 7. That's a 9. I'll put it here. And then I will draw a fence right there. And then I just have to draw one more fence, and I have all my fencing I need for my city projects. We have a 4 biz, which might not be bad, an 8 biz, and a 7 estate. I'm going to take the 4 biz. And I'm going to put the 4 biz, I'm going to put the 4 right here. And then I'm going to biz this 3. And so I'm going to take another point. Now I'm losing 3 points to business. But now to complete my city projects, I just have to put a house here, here, and here. So I'm really close to completing all my projects. I just haven't completed... Oh, I have completed one project. So I've completed the second project. I just noticed that. Oh, no, because I'm not cashing... I guess I can put that anywhere. So yeah, sure. I'm going to draw a line above that one and draw a line above this one. And that gets me 8 points for city project number 2. So I would flip that over. So let's say that city projects 1 and 2 have been completed, but not the third one so far. So we can keep going. And we have a 1 estate, we have a 4 park, and we have an 8 park. And so I could take that 8 park and put it right there and get points for the park. And then I have those 2 estates as well. So that would give me 3 points on city project number 1. We'll go ahead and flip this over. 8 estate, the 6 biz, and the 2 park. I can use the 2 park. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to use the 2 park right here. I don't get the pool. I fill that bubble in. Now, normally here, we would shuffle. But I'm going to go ahead and say that another player completed the third city project, and they have all 3 city projects done, so they've finished the game, instead of having the shuffle or whatnot. So I'd go ahead and score. So I wouldn't have any points for the third city project, which is not good for me because that is the highest project. So for the projects, I got 11 points. For parks, I got 4 points on my top street, 6 points on my middle street, and 4 points on the bottom street for a total of 14. I got 26 points in my pools. I had 3 temp agencies. Let's go ahead and say that was the most, so I'll get 7 for that. I didn't do nearly as well in the estates as I probably would have liked, but again, I was just going through this very quickly. So let's go ahead and give me 7 points for each of my 4 estates that I completed, which is 14 points. I get 6 points for my 1-6 estate. I get 3 points each for my 2-3 estates, so that's 6 points, and that's all I have for estates. I'm going to lose 3 points there. I did not take any building refusals, and I did not build any roundabouts, so I don't lose any points from there. And I would add all of that up, and that would be my final score for the game. That is how you set up all the rules and how to play Welcome To. I hope that all made sense. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments, and I will do my best to answer them. As well as remember, leaving a comment earns you an entry into Board Game Trick or Treat. Let's go ahead, come back off the table. I will give you my final thoughts on this and, of course, my Roc rating for Welcome To. Now it's time for my final thoughts on Welcome To. And Welcome To reintroduced me to the roll and write, flip and write genre. As my first hobby board game in that genre, I had, you know, previously played games like Yahtzee, and I think I would consider Boggle even a roll and write kind of game. But again, those are mass market style games, and in the board game hobby, Welcome To was the first game in that style that I played. And it really flipped, in my opinion, it flipped the whole board game industry on its head. Because since that time, we've had, you know, games in the genre more than ever before. Everything is getting a roll and write. You're having roll and writes that create spin-offs into regular board games. You're having roll and writes that get sequels. You're having board games getting made into roll and writes or flip and writes. And, like, it's all about the roll and write, flip and write genre right now in board gaming for the last couple of years. It's been going strong and doesn't show any signs of stopping, even to the fact that the game Welcome To itself got a sequel game in Welcome To New Las Vegas. And that's even very strong. This game has made an immense impact on the board game industry and the hobby and gamers in general. And I think it's for the better. It has a small shelf and table footprint. It doesn't take a lot to it, but there's so many good things about it. And there's so much player availability just in the city plans. And then how, when you play with different people have different play styles. Some people like to play the longer games where they get more points and try to, you know, plan out everything perfectly. And then you have other players who like to rush games and maybe try to get to that end game as quick as possible to deny those longer players the way that they like to play. And so you take all those into consideration, you've already got a ton of replayability in what is ultimately a fairly small box. And then they added different thematic neighborhoods. So you have your standard player sheet like this. But then they've made other thematic neighborhoods. They've made one for spring, which is an Easter egg theme. They have Halloween. They have Winter Wonderland, where you're stringing up Christmas lights. There's summer, where you have ice cream cones. There is a Doomsday one, where you're building bunkers, and a Outbreak one, where you're fighting off zombies. I believe that's all of them. Yes. That's all the ones that I have, at least. There might be other ones out there that I'm not positive on, or they might have other ones in the works from the point of this video. And then on top of all of that, so you've got all those other replayabilities, and each one of those come with their own additional city plans that you can use as well. So replayability to the max. Then there is also a free app on mobile that you can download. That instead of using a player sheet, you can keep track of all of your scoring on the mobile app. Now, you still need the cards to play, or somebody needs the cards to play. But what you can do is then you can have, instead of having to write everything down on the score sheet, if you prefer, you can play on a mobile app. And when you're doing things like right now with, you know, distancing and everything that's going on, we can play online using that mobile app. And so my friends over at Deepwater Games with Oxi Media have been hosting Welcome To games on their Twitch channel. And I'm going to go ahead and link to that in the description below as well, so that you can go and take a look and see if you can jump in on some games when Elle hosts the games over there. Elle is a great host, and I would like to say she's a friend, that Elle is a friend of mine. They are very, very nice, and they're always looking for new players. So if you're ever interested in playing a game of Welcome To, and you do or you do not have a copy, you can always download the mobile app, join a game of Welcome To on the Oxi Media Twitch page, and Elle will be happy to have you play with them as well. So with all of that said, with all the ways that you can play this game, it is definitely worth your time to either get a copy or, you know, play with in ways like that mobily. And I really do enjoy the game. Now it's time for my Roc rating. And Rolling with Roc gives Welcome To an Ultra Ball rating. This game is definitely making my top 67 games of all time, and it will be fairly high, so stay tuned to my list that releases every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday to see where this game falls on that list. You will see quite a few flip and write and roll and write games on that list, because that genre is a lot of fun right now, and there is a lot of creativity in the genre of flip and write and roll and write. But probably a big portion of that has to be attributed to Welcome To. This game, at least from my knowledge, Welcome To brought flipping rights and rolling rights into the mainstream. If there were games before that, then I apologize, and I don't remember that. This was the one that opened up, in my opinion, everybody's eyes to the genre, and then all the other publishers and everybody else was like, well, we got to make a roll and write or a flip and write, because, and there's other great flip and writes and roll and writes out there, and I'm going to cover those on the channel as we go. But just like I said in my list with Dominion for deck builders, without Welcome 2, we might not even have the genre, or at least not as big as it is now. So just for one, giving us a genre that, or improving a genre that I hold very dear, and in also getting a spin-off game that I may like even more than this one, but I like them both, and they're different games. So hopefully someday I'll be able to cover Welcome to New Las Vegas and explain the differences in those. But this game brings a whole experience on building, where you're an architect and making your housing plans and getting everything in order. It does all of that so well in a small box, in a great price point. This is a game that I'm never going to say you have to buy a game, but this is one that if you have the budget to do so, if you like these style of games and you don't own it yet, I highly recommend that you go look for a copy of this. And that is Welcome 2 from Blue Cocker and Deepwater Games. That'll do it for today's Roc review on Welcome 2. Remember, if you leave a comment below telling me if you like this game, if you've tried it, if you want to look for it, and you've already subscribed to this channel, that gets you entered into Board Game Trick or Treat. Right now would be a great time to play the Halloween variant of this game. Here we are in October, or ROCtober, as I would say. So, great time to play Welcome 2, great time to play the Halloween variant if you have that, and the app allows you to play any of those variants if you have the cards. You just can, even if you don't have the player sheets, you can play right on the app, which is amazing. And like I said, the app's free. I will link to that in the description below as well. Please go ahead and share this video and all of my content with your friends. Anybody that you know that likes board games, please, it does the world for me when you help me grow like that. Also, I just recently achieved Twitch affiliate over on my Twitch channel, twitch.tv/rollingwithroc. I do board games Sunday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern, and I'll do just random streams of Among Us as we go. I'm also planning on a couple of collaborations soon with a couple other board game YouTubers and streamers, so I'm really excited for that down the line and can't wait to announce that stuff to you guys. So thank you so much for watching all these videos, and I hope you have a great rest of your day. Tomorrow, Wednesday, will be the top 67 games of all time, numbers 55 through 51. And until then, we'll see you next time. This was AJ from Rolling with ROC.